Okay, well, welcome everybody. This is Pukajay Podcasts number 2. My name is Ben Van Kirkwick. I am recording this second attempt at a podcast out of my home up in Northern California in Auburn.
And I'm Luke Williamson. I'm not recording this second attempt out of my house in Lindos Roads, Greece.
Great. Yes, we're Pukajay Productions. We are a production team working on a documentary looking at human civilizations, looking at the very kind of roots of our history as a species, of where we've come from. We're trying to build up. There's lots of new evidence that is out there now that is kind of challenging the orthodox perspective of, you know, human race coming out in a linear line from 6,000 sort of years ago to where we are today. There's lots of new evidence supporting the idea that we've been around for a lot longer than that. So, you know, we're working on content and media and ultimately a documentary exploring those topics and trying to make the call that that says, you know, it's time to go and have another look at our history, take another look that looks at all of the evidence coming not just from archaeological fields but also from other, you know, adjacent scientific fields like geology, paleoclimatology, all of these different things, and take another look at what it means for human history.
Absolutely. I think it's really time that we start doing this. As Graham Hancock likes to say, you know, stuff just keeps getting older all the time.
That's right.
And I was just reading something the other day about, and this is, you know, this is 10, 12 years old, this stuff, and it's just, it's not really talked about very much, but, you know, an archaeologist out of the University of Savannah finding, you know, radiocarbon, carbonized remains of plants next to human remains in a riverbank in Savannah, that show that, you know, humans have been living in North America for at least 50,000 years. That's their minimum, you know, amount of time they've been here.
Yeah. We're clever buggers.
Yeah, and I think, you know, that we're going to start to see that this, you know, this sort of ice bridge and, you know, the out of Africa theory are sort of going to start maybe slipping away a little bit and being replaced by perhaps a more interesting story.
Yeah, who knows? I mean, the ultimate fact of the fossil record says that, you know, we've been here 195,000, 200,000 years. The date keeps getting pushed back every time they dig something up. And certainly the Earth's surface looked an awful lot different during that period. In fact, as recently as about 15,000 years ago, I mean, that was during the last of the Pleistocene Ice Age, when sea levels were 100 meters lower than what they are now, things looked radically different. It's something we'll get into as we talk about the topic for today's podcast, which is Gunung Padang, a place in Indonesia, and we'll get into that, you know, in a minute here. But that's, you know, that's one of the key assumptions with this whole perspective, is that if you look at human progress, human achievement in the last few generations, I mean, we are anatomically the same humans that have been here for that 200,000 year period. It seems almost inconceivable that, you know, given ideal conditions, or at least sustainable and workable conditions, you know, having generation upon generation, we're the thing that sets us apart from other species is our ability to do things like generational learning. You know, we can teach and we can inherit knowledge from our immediate ancestors and from our forebears, and, you know, in a way that, you know, if you spend a lifetime learning how to do something, you can immediately pass that knowledge on to the next generation, and their progress happens. I mean, we've come an awful long way in the last, let's say, 200 years in this time, which is all of about 8 generations. And there's been something like 7,000 generations since the start of humanity. I mean, it's hard to think that it's only the last fraction of that that has really launched off into, you know, into progress that's led directly to our civilization today. And, you know, that's you know, there's a lot in that theme to explore. And one of those themes that ties in, one of the big proof points that's coming up, there's a big thorn in the side of kind of the orthodox story. Story is this place called Gunung Padang in Indonesia.
Yeah, it's a very interesting site. I'm going there actually in 4 or 5 days. I'll be there, which is pretty exciting. But you know, I've just been doing a lot of research based on Danny Hillman and Natarajan's work. I hope I didn't butcher his name too badly. And Dr. Robert Schock. And, you know, these guys they're very well educated. They know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
They're not in the business of making things up. And I think a lot of this stuff really begs for some closer examination.
You're right. Actually, so what I've got maybe by way of introduction, and we talked about this a little earlier, something a little different here, is I've got a little clip that maybe we'll play for the next 5 minutes, kind of by way of introduction to Gunung Padang, if you haven't if you haven't heard of this site before, and it's from someone that's far more eloquent than I, Graham Hancock, in one of his lectures, talking about his new book, Magicians of the Gods, which Gunung Padang is discussed. He's been there, and Luke, as Luke said, he's going there shortly, so we're going to get a good look at this site as well. But he has there's a 5 or 6 minute clip of him sort of introducing the site, talking about where it is and some of the aspects of it and how it's changed, and some of the actually interesting parts about this are some of the politics that surround this site, some of the things we'll talk about after this clip. So let me play this, and Luke, if you know, let me know how this sounds for you. If it's...
Go to Java and go to Bandung and drive 3 hours west, and you will come to Gunung Padang. Gunung Padang is a site that's been known about for quite a long time, since about 1914, actually. And it was thought to be about 2,500 years old. It's a megalithic site, obviously. It's actually made of a natural material called columnar basalt. But the columnar basalt has been used as a building block, as building blocks by whoever made this megalithic site. I'm just to show you around the site a little bit more, a few more images of how it looks, the very top of the site. And I'm there again with Danny Hillman, the Natawijaja, who is the geologist, the Caltech-trained PhD geologist who is doing the work at Gunung Padang. Just show you a few more pictures of it, and then let's pull back and look at Gunung Padang. Look at actually what it is. That megalithic site is on top of something, which for a long time was thought to be a natural hill. And all of the archaeological work, such as it was, and it was minimal, had only been done on the top, on these terraces, and nobody was paying any attention to what went on down below, except Danny Hillman. By the way, his middle name is Hillman because when his mother was rushed to hospital in labor with him, they were driving in a Hillman car. Danny Hillman Natawijaja. He decided that he would take a look at that odd-looking hill from a geological point of view using the latest geological tech. And they did a thorough investigation of it using seismic tomography, using electrical imaging, getting a look inside it. And what they discovered is that it is, in fact, a man-made pyramid with multiple chambers inside it. And the megalithic site on top is just the latest stage of a very long development at Gunung Padang. They did some drilling using tubular drills, drilling down drill cores into the depths of the pyramid, and they started pulling up man-made artifacts and carbon-datable organic material. And they started getting very ancient dates, going back 16,000 years and more. There's the date at the top, 2,500 years before the present, but then we go back further, 28,000 years, 23,000 years, 13,000 years. And they're also finding very high resistivity bodies inside the Gunung Padang pyramid, which are chambers, regular chambers. And in fact, there are three of them which have been identified. So naturally, this is a very tempting place for an archaeological investigation. You would have thought, after the geologists had opened the road, that the archaeologists would really want to get in there and dig. Instead, what they did was they created a huge amount of trouble for Danny and his team, and they said, look, we know this site is 2,500 years old. There is absolutely no point in doing any further investigation of it at all. The funds for that would be much better used on our projects. And Danny and his team were stopped for the best part of a year until, in December 2013, Danny succeeded in bringing the then president of Indonesia, President Yudhoyono, to Gunung Padang and showed him the site and showed him the evidence. And Yudhoyono said, you know what? You go ahead and excavate this site. Don't listen to those archaeologists. It took a while to get it going, but they started excavating in August 2014. Immediately, there was an outcry from archaeologists. Here's Bandung Archaeological Center head Desriel Shanti has taken issue with the excavation process being carried out at Gunung Padang, adding that the process had not followed standard methods. "I've yet to go to the site," she says, "but I can judge it from photographs." Again, this is the kind of thing that we're up against. Here's the problem. President Yudo Yono stepped down at the beginning of October, and President Widodo took over, and the excavation was immediately stopped. And that's where we're at the moment. The excavation stopped on the 1st of October. Danny and his team are still working to get the excavation restarted. He wrote to me on the 2nd of October that the research progress has been great. They've uncovered lots more stone artifacts. The existence of the pyramid-like structure beneath the megalithic site is now loud and clear. We found some kind of open hall buried by soil 5 to 7 meters thick, but we haven't got into it yet. And they still haven't got into it because they've been cleared off the site. Sometimes, I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but sometimes I wonder if there's some kind of conspiracy going on to prevent us knowing the truth about our past.
Well, interesting site.
Well, I think it's pretty clear that if it's not a conspiracy, there's definitely a concerted effort to keep things in the current status quo, keep the understanding where it is.
That's right. I think that comes from, and we sort of talked about this a little bit in the last podcast, which is kind of the nature of academia in a science such as archaeology or Egyptology. You pick your poison in your certain areas. Like, you know, it's not a global field, right? It's very specific to individual areas, be it the Mediterranean, Egypt, Indonesia, those types of areas. You have experts that have built up a picture of the past that is, you know, determined by all this evidence that's on the ground, and they're authority, their positions, and, you know, they're even in some cases maybe their personal, I guess the way they, their personal power, how they think about themselves is really tightly coupled to this story. And then when you get evidence that suggests that your story is completely wrong, that, or maybe not wrong, but just it's incomplete, because absolutely it's true that there were probably people using Gunung Padang, and as Graham said, that the top of the pyramid is the latest work, right? That was done,
yes,
1500 to 2500 BC. But the deeper you get, the more the
older
it's older, and there's man-made artifacts. The whole thing looks like it's man-made, and this blows the story out the water. So, you know, this is a very challenging concept. If you have a position of power and academic status that's derived from a story that is all of a sudden under threat, right? You feel threatened. So I think there's maybe, it feels like a conspiracy, I think, at times, but also I think it's some ways it's going to be human nature that people in positions of authority will try to maintain the status quo. I mean, that is the very nature of establishment. You know, it's to maintain the status quo. It's to resist a lot of change.
So. Well, you know, they're sitting in a boat, and they, you know, they possibly don't gain from the rocking of the boat. But no. If the boat stays still, they know they're okay.
The boat's leaking.
Yeah.
The boat is leaking.
So it's, you know, I think there's something just to be, two things, actually. First of all, I think Graham said basalt, and I think technically it's actually andesite, which, especially when it's wet, does look a lot like basalt. And I don't want to be in the position of correcting someone like Graham Hancock, because, you know, he's obviously very thorough generally, but everything, all the research I've done has, you know, from Robert Schock and from Dr. Natawajaja, has said andesite. So, so I think, you know, we're looking at, and one, the other thing that we shouldn't confuse is that, you know, there's a difference between the layers and the terraces. You know, there's five different terraces, there's five different layers.
Right. So maybe describe the whole site, what it is. It's, you know, it's out in the middle of the woods, how you get there. I mean, maybe describe the whole picture, paint people a picture of how you get there and what it looks like.
It is. It's in Western Java. It's not far from Mount Geed, if that's how you pronounce it. Maybe it's pronounced Geed. I don't know, G-E-D-E. And it's in a volcanic area. Mount Geed has erupted several times in our recent histories, 4 to 6,000 years. Right. Basically it's a very large hilltop. It's about 3,000 feet. I think it's 884 meters, something like that, above sea level.
Yeah.
But if we're talking about before the last ice age melt, it would have been significantly higher.
Well, 300 feet high, right? That's about the sea level. Yeah.
Right. It looks at it actually is facing Mount Geed too. So there's a thought that at a later time when they constructed the later terraces or the terraces on the last phase on the top, that there may have been ceremonies that they were doing to placate the volcano. Again, that's a very common sort of idea because, you know, we tend to think of, you know, our ancestors as being savages who, you know, worshipped nature and what a terrible thing that is. And it possibly that's what they were doing. You know, they were trying to placate the volcano. Possibly there were other, purposes that aren't so obvious.
Yeah, Indonesia is located in a ring of fire there, so there's lots of volcanoes. And this is out in the bush. I mean, you take it's a 3-hour, 4-hour drive to cover, you know, like 100 kilometers. So it's all dirt, rocky road today. It's all fully overgrown. I mean, it looks like a natural hilltop with trees on it, it's grass. It's hard to distinguish what it is, right? I mean, from everything I've seen of it, as you sort of got to climb up a long, that takes a half an hour to climb to the top of this, and then there's these terraces on top, but what you don't realize is you've actually been climbing up the side of what is effectively a man-made pyramid that rivals the size of the stuff we see in Egypt.
I mean, just this idea, you know, when you're booking hotels for the place, you're trying to find the place that's closest to it, you know, and then I picked a hotel that's, you know, 23 miles or something from the site, and I'm like, right, that's great. You know, it seems to be almost the closest hotel, and I'm like, that's great. You know, you just whip down to the site, and then you start looking, and you start realizing that 25 miles is going to take you, if there's no traffic, it's going to take you almost 2 hours, if there's any kind of traffic, you know, and out there. It's, you know, the roads are very windy,
it's a site. I mean, it's just to give people the picture of it, and obviously we'll tack on we'll add some video to this site so people get an idea and they can see around it. But it really is in the middle of the jungle, and it's just one of those areas that, you know, you find things you're not expecting to find. I think it's you know, for the longest time, and this site's been around there for a while, and the evidence that shows up on top. I mean, this is to be clear that those terraces that are on top, there's five terraces that sort of ascend up after each other that you get to. Those do show evidence of human use, and most of the archaeologists date that to about 1500 BC to 2500 BC. But what happened when Danny Hillman and his team came on, they're geologists, and they did some geology work in terms of, you know, analyzing that site with ground penetrating radar, all sorts of tools that were actually given to them by the Graham told the story about the president of Indonesia coming over and looking at the site. He actually gave them the funding and all the tools to go and do this work that then has shown with these core samples and everything that the stuff that they pulled up out of the ground that they've carbon dated has came back with these just astonishing results. I mean, it's hard to question when you are digging up a site and you've got human remains and human, you know, organic remains that can only sort of really are only explained by being there is with human presence and cavities inside this space that are all that all sort of determined by the latest in geological and ground penetrating tools. It's sort of hard to argue with, but this is what the archaeologists are arguing against, right? Because they've looked at the top of it, and the whole site doesn't match their picture, so they tried to shut it down.
It is very modern equipment. The techniques they've been using have been very, very state of the art, very recent state of the art. And, you know, the five terraces are all actually part of layer one, which is the latest, the top layer.
That's right.
And, you know, the layer five, what's really interesting, because according to the conventional idea of this is that the only human-made parts are the terraces, the very top part, and the rest of it is the neck of an ancient volcano. And and to be clear, this columnar andesite, you know, it's formed naturally, like in the shape of they look like logs almost, stone logs. They're actually naturally sort of rough hexagonal shapes,
like crystalline, and they come up,
they come up in a large like honeycomb shape, you know, they push through the ground in this honeycomb shape. And what has obviously happened at this site is that, you know, ancient peoples have broken these along like the honeycomb fracture lines, and they've made individual logs out of these things that normally appear vertical.
Yep.
And they've laid them and stacked them in an interlocking fashion, in a horizontal fashion. What's really interesting is when you go down, you get down to the base layer, the layer five. Now, this layer is estimated by the core samples and the material that they've brought up to be between 22 to 20,000 BC. So, you know, we're talking about stuff that is really, really old. And what Danny Hillman has found is that, you know, his structural analysis of, you know, that fifth layer, you know, involves these andesite columns that are cast sort of in horizontal stacks, layer upon layer, you know, reaching 26 meters in height. And they're like, you know, 3 meter long magnetic sort of style plinths, and that are put atop this volcanic tuff, T-U-F-F, bedrock, you know, in these horizontal rows. And it's done, you know, clearly for withstanding, you know, tectonic activity. And what he's discovered at these very ancient, very old layers is this sort of orangey, cement, you know, style mortar that's this sort of, you know, geopolymer. And, you know, they're able to date, you know, this stuff and figure out how old it is. And, you know, the fact that they're stacked up at that bottom layer in that way just completely indicates that it was done intentionally, you know, by somebody.
Right. And then to put that into perspective, I mean, when you look at that whole hillock on that whole hilltop that they thought was natural with these terraces on top, it's 110 meters high. That's 300, it's 340, 300 something, 340 odd feet high. It's a stepped pyramid. So, you know, it's not, the angle on it isn't as sharp as you would say you'd see at the Great Pyramid of Giza. It's more of a sloped angle, but all that, what that means is that the base is much wider. Like, you're talking about just a massive pyramid. Like, this is, it rivals literally the mass of the Great Pyramids. In fact, I think that the biggest, the most mass, the highest mass pyramid isn't actually in Egypt. It's somewhere else. And it's in South America somewhere, I think. And it's a similar style of pyramid to Gunung Padang, which is a step pyramid that has a lower angle. But because if you still want to reach the height that you want to reach for whatever reason you're shooting for, it just means you got to make the actual pyramid itself bigger at a shallower angle. And that's kind of the style of this pyramid. Although it's not extremely shallow. It's shallow enough that the site itself is, doesn't it cover something like 10 acres? I mean, the Great Pyramid is acres and this site's about 10 or something.
I think it's about 55 hectares or something. The entire site is quite large.
I'll stick the right answer in the video about here.
So. Right. But, you know, the other interesting thing is that in the fourth layer, there are, and the fourth layer, these aren't like flat layers. You know, they sort of come in at an angle and then they angle quite sharply up towards the top and then they level up and then the next layer comes in and does the sort of the same thing. By the time you get to the third layer, they're going almost directly straight up and then across and then up and then across. Yeah. But anyway, we'll put a good diagram up about this, but in the fourth layer, which comes up and then sharply cuts and actually goes underneath the first 3.5 to 4 terraces, There are chambers that they have found.
I want to talk about the chambers. You know,
seismically, and the entrances to these chambers are actually in layer 3. And Dr. Robert Schock has tossed the idea around that this whole site was built around a naturally existing cave system that they then enhanced, and possibly has something to do with you know, the need to shelter from the sun or from the environment for, you know, a period of time where you wouldn't necessarily want to be above ground. It was not particularly beneficial. So, you know, he feels fairly comfortable talking about that.
Well, I know he's very much focused on that, the plasma event, solar, right. There's lots of evidence supporting. I think, I mean, it's interesting. I mean, getting to cave systems, I mean, how far underground do you have to go, and how much of a pyramid do you really have to build on top of it once you get underground? Right. It would be like, what's the rest of the pyramid for? Would be the immediate question that comes to my mind.
Question whether those chambers would be large enough for people to live and survive in. From what I've seen there, I haven't seen evidence of that, but no. I don't think we really know everything that's down there yet.
No, we don't. I think that let's be clear about at least what my understanding of the chambers that they found out. So they're just using the seismographic techniques, and there's some good sort of 3D imagery of what Graham mentioned in his video as being very high resistivity bodies, which, you know, you're sending a signal through the earth, and then it's hard to pass an air gap. That's a high level of resistance for these signals. So they show up as high resistivity. So there's three chambers they found. And from what I understand, the biggest one being about 10 meters.
Right.
And it's got, as you said, there are entrances to it. So they've kind of almost got a little, they've got a real rough outline of what they think could be rooms and could be structures underneath the surface of this pyramid. But they're, as Graham said, from what I understand, they're yet to explore them and yet to get down into them and do anything other than drill core samples and carbon dating and tools that you can sort of hit this thing from the outside. So it really hasn't been excavated. There's, from what I understand, this, when Graham was talking about the work got stopped in October, that was October of 2014, and I don't believe anything's really happened of significance on the site since. Not we know about.
They haven't continued. But anyway, so it's worth mentioning that first phase, the fifth layer, the lowest layer is, as I said, is 22 to 20,000 BC. The next phase, they've dated at 14,700 BC. And then the third layer is 9,600 BC, which is around the time Göbekli Tepe was buried. It's around the time of the ice age, the end of the last ice age. The Younger Dryas event. So that time period just keeps popping up again and again at ancient sites, something happening like around that time, some significant construction or effort put into structures around that time.
And it's
the second layer, I'll just finish very quickly, is around 4,700 BC. And then the final layer, the terracing is around now, they're saying 2,800 BC.
Right. So what you're looking at here is not, it's hard to think of it as a pyramid, because if you go by this picture, it's something like a stepped series of man-made constructions that has been constructed over, it sounds like, tens of thousands of years almost, like that has been worked on and inhabited. And yeah, that there was an interesting, like you said, that third layer that corresponds to around the end of the at least the Younger Dryas boundary, as they call it.
Right.
This is a date that keeps popping up, because it is a date that's very significant in the history of the planet. It's worth repeating the Younger Dryas story is that this is also something that has come up with new evidence, much like what we're finding in Gunung and Padang. Again, another really good, when you take all of these things in concert, it really does affect the picture we have of human history. So sites like Gunung and Padang, where we say date back past this boundary, getting the Younger Dryas work itself, which is analyzing temperature or ice core samples out of places like Greenland, that they actually had to drill it for 5 years. So people don't realize how difficult, like these Younger Dryas boundary graphs and the temperature samples that they show, these cataclysmic events that they now correlate to what was effectively a comet impact into the northern hemisphere of the Earth about 12,800 years ago. To get to those, just a quick story, but to get to those ice core samples, I mean, this is stuff I re-listened to a lot of Randall Carlson's work. I'd really encourage people to do a bit of look him up and watch his podcast with Rogan. Really great stuff, because I mean, they drilled for 5 years. They were there was an American and I think a French team. I should know, but the teams that were up in Greenland, they drilled for 5 years to get to the depth of that period of time where you could actually pull these out, analyze the oxygen isotopes, analyze things like the CO2 level, all that type of data that, it takes a long time to get and to analyze out. And this new research shows that we had this climatic traumatic event that rose sea levels 100 meters over a very short period of time that changed the surface of the Earth. And this is sites like Gunung and Padang that were central in a landmass, right? I mean, back if you look at the maps of the world and pictures of the world, or during the last ice age, just before the Younger Dryas event, when that ice age was ending, the sea level was, 100 meters lower than where it is now, 300 feet. That just has a dramatic effect on the coastlines of all of the continents. I mean, there's a whole shelf. If you look at Australia, it was, it's connected to Papua New Guinea, and there's only a small gap between that was likely frozen over in an ice bridge into the landmass that was Indonesia, which was all connected via land up into Malaysia. And now, after this event that just changed the surface of the Earth and nowhere more dramatically than Indonesia, I mean, it turned it into an archipelago of islands as we see it today, and likely happened in a very short period of time. So whatever was going on at that site, whatever civilization was strong enough to build, a massive series of stepped pyramids in this site and that they would have been wiped out. I mean, there's really, and this was 9,600 years ago.
Yeah. I think it's worth noting at this point too. I mean, this whole area you're talking about too, around Indonesia and between Indonesia and Micronesia, these areas, a sunken area that was very fertile land before then, and would have been, you know, inhabited and used by animals, people, and all the rest of it. And it's an area now called Sunderland. There's quite a lot of material on it if you want to look at it. But I think it's worth noting that you know, in indigenous Indonesian lore, and I'm not going to get into the story in too much depth, you know, they have a very well-documented, intricate history that involves an incredible flood story, which is really like Adam and Eve, because it involves one couple that survived and was able to eventually rebuild, you know, their civilization from the one couple. So it's got some very sort of biblical, you know, elements to it, as most of these stories do, because they're all the same story. But, you know, it's worth noting that, you know, they have that in their natural lore. They still remember, you know, these stories themselves. And they're still actually very superstitious. They still do ceremony up there to prevent Mount Geed from erupting again several times a year. Yeah. Stuff like that. They're still...
Well, we should.
Superstitious is probably the wrong word. I should probably use the respectful of nature, perhaps.
Yeah, I mean, you're just more connected to. I mean, I think anywhere that, I mean, we lose sight of this living in cities, right, and towns in the modern first world. I mean, I hate to call places that our Western culture as is experienced in big cities. You lose touch with the environment. We're just surrounded by electric lights. You see the moon, a couple stars at night. And we're inside when it rains or it's winding it's windy and it's snowing, those types of things, right? I mean, but when you're a bit more exposed to the elements, if you're living in these local cultures and you're sort of dependent on the environment, the resources, you're dependent on the food that you grow, you have a much closer relationship to nature. So yeah, I mean, these stories of when nature bites back, I mean, when volcanoes erupt or when cataclysms happen. I mean, this is. If you look at another thing that I sourced from Randall Carlson, but this is sort of a small aside to this story. But when you talk about indigenous traditions, and you look at the North American Indian traditions, and if you actually map out how many have lore and legend of cataclysmic starts event. to their societies, like where it's a huge floods, and I mean all of them across North America have these legends, which is basically what happened 12,800 years ago. We know this now, that when these glaciers melted, it caused the world flood, it caused this inundation that's referenced in so many cultures and in so many religions. I mean, the funny thing is something else. I mean, the word cataclysm itself, it comes from the Greek kataklysmos, which means to destroy water. I mean, there's an equivalent word to that means destroy with fire, and it was kind of the Greek, it was the Greek religion and the Greek myth of how they looked at how the world was rebirthed by fire and by water. But cataclysm, the word itself, and how we use it today, people don't realize when you say cataclysm, you're specifically saying death by water. That's the etymology of the word.
Yeah, it's you know, it's fascinating stuff. I mean, obviously our you know, we've survived this sort of thing somehow, you know, a couple of times. There's some, I don't know, we met and interviewed and talked with Brian Forster when we were in South America at the end of last year, and you know, we were really focusing on ancient structures and civilization, but of course Brian has also done a lot of almost curative research, because he researches and he protects, you know, what he finds. You know, he's really into, you know, the Paracas skulls, the elongated skulls, and these odd, you know, sort of races, or, you know, that they found in, and some of them are 800 years old and some of them are 2000 years old. And he had a very hard time getting the DNA tested, but the DNA results have finally come in from very respectable labs.
Yeah. He's just released his videos, right?
He's just released these videos. You should look him up. And, every single skull, elongated skull that they tested, had European DNA, even the ones that are 2,300 years old. So when you look at stuff like that, and you look at the mummies that they found in Egypt that have coca, you know, in their DNA,
they even had coca remains, leaves, right?
They even had coca, leaves in the tombs. You know, there's only one place.
Linen, right? In the mummies, didn't they? Yeah. They found coca leaves, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, that's only coming from one place. You know, the Vikings undoubtedly reached North America. I mean, we've in several periods in our ancient past, you know, we've had travel, you know, between the continents. Yeah,
that's right.
It's something that we need to accept and we need to really start moving forward with.
That's really the conclusion you got to come to with that. And it's just all of this stuff is indicative of, and remember, these people, this is not just random remains. In a lot of cases, these elongated skull people that have these European origins, or these, at least these DNA that challenges the Orthodox story, they were mummified, they were revered. Like how often do you see elongated skull type people that are either drawn or depicted? I mean, almost all these stuff in Egypt and the double crowns, the shapes of the heads, they're elongated. This, all of it, you can take it, you can take the you can speculate along a lot of different ways, but what it really does indicate is that something was going on in antiquity that was far more global. We've been far more intermixed. We've likely been far more connected in the past. I mean, this, all of these things kind of do add up and provide proof points to that. At this point, I mean, we'll see how that. I'd be interested to see how that research gets treated from Brian, and if it gets picked up by any mainstream.
I think they'll try to discredit him. But there's been also very recent. I mean, in the last month or something, 3 weeks, I've read several articles on Native American tribes from North America that have had their DNA assessed, and it doesn't come from Northeast Asia. It comes from the Middle East. And it's getting really hard to deny, you know, at a certain point that people weren't everywhere,
right? Yeah,
long time ago.
It's cyclical. I think there's, and it's a lesson that's taught to us in so many different religions and histories and belief systems, even that the cyclical nature of birth and destruction. I mean, this, and it's something. I think it's lessons that we've learned in the past. I mean, you know, we're understanding that these things were much more vulnerable than we thought we were. Certainly in a longer time scales, right? It's easy to live a life of, or even generations. And in our case, a civilization has occurred in a period of time, call it the last 4,000 or 5,000 years, where there hasn't been anything massively catastrophic happen. I mean, I think we used to think this only happened every, you know, like the Yucatan event
65 million
years ago, killed the dinosaurs. But now there's maps. If you go and look, I mean, the examples right there is the moon. Look at the moon. You can see how battered the moon is because it doesn't have a surface layer and atmosphere to protect it. And there are now some maps available and some good data that shows kind of what the Earth looks like after all of these impacts. I mean, I've really been into the catastrophism side of this lately because Carlson's been doing a lot of interesting stuff. There's this thing called Burkle Crater. And this was something that was like a couple miles wide that landed in the Indian Ocean, and it's explained and shown by these just incredible U-shaped, or these basically, the think of them as like splash waves from a pond, right? Ripple waves from this massive stone that hit the Indian Ocean's about a mile wide and hit it at probably 20 miles a second, and just pounded out these tsunamis that then washed up, and it's all evidence that's shown on Madagascar and on the western coast of Australia. But it's, you're talking about tsunamis that are like 1,000 feet high,
right?
And that they've washed inland to almost like 600-700 feet, and that's up off sea level, and they've gone in 50 miles. I mean, that's the type of destruction we're talking about that happens periodically, and it's the type of destruction we've escaped. But it's definitely the type of thing that was going to end civilization, and I think this is. These are lessons that are encoded and taught to us in so many different belief systems and messages from the past. It's just that, you know, as Graham says, we kind of have amnesia about it.
Yeah, there's so many options for, you know, destruction. I mean, it can come, you know, from outside of our atmosphere, or it can, you know, come from massive sort of tectonic and volcanic situations, or possibly changes in the magnetic field. But like you were saying about the Earth and the Moon, how the Moon is cratered. I mean, yeah, if you take the water away from the Earth and you look at it, it kind of looks like a half-eaten apple. You know, it's certainly not round. It's round because of the water. It's not really a round planet if you took the water away, from what I've seen.
Yeah, we're missing. But
I want to talk very briefly about the A word, because we're talking about that 9600 BC, and if you read your Plato and you read your Timaeus and Critias, You know, Plato talks, he does. He's the guy that we have this Atlantis, this A word, you That's know, that everybody goes, oh my God, you must believe in Atlantis. You must
and aliens.
Yeah. And aliens and all the rest of it. But the interesting thing, if you look at the date that Plato gives for the destruction of Atlantis, it's 9600 BC. And I just think that that is a tremendous, tremendous coincidence, which of course is when geologists say is, you know, the end of the last ice age.
That's the end of the young.
And he's talking there. about the end of an advanced civilization that was swallowed by water at pretty much, you know, that exact
in a day and night.
Right. And there's also this thing I was talking to Ben about a little bit last week called the Bok, the B-O-C-K saga, which is a Norse indigenous history that was passed down through a family that may be, you know, totally crazy, but it's very interesting from what I've read of it. I'm only about halfway through it. But what they talk about is the word Atlantis is actually an old Finnish or Norse word, and it doesn't mean a place, it means a time, and the word is actually Altlandis, A-L-T-L-A-N-D-I-S, and Altlandis means all land is ice, and I think that's just sort of an interesting kind of thing to throw in there. I mean, I don't know how much weight you can place on it, but...
There's lots of there is a lot of data that's encoded in a lot of these stories, and it's probably worth mentioning also that's the Hamlet's Mill is that the
right.
Just a great book that well great it's a tough book to read. I gotta confess I haven't read all of it. I've read chunks of it. It's about specific things, but it does a real tight sort of mathematical analysis and a look at the encoding of significant numbers and mathematics in all of these myths, and certainly Norse mythology is one of them. And it looks at knowledge of precession. So precession being the roughly 26,000 year cycle of the heavens. It's where the sun rises on the solstice. Okay. Under what constellation it is in each constellation, each phase of the precession is about, what is it, 2,600 years for each phase of precession, and it goes backwards through the zodiac. So we're currently in the age of Pisces, going backwards towards the age of Aquarius. And, you know, there's lots of analogies to this that are encoded in religion. And one of them they certainly look at is the Norse religion. And it turns out that in a bunch of these tales, and this is the details are all laid out in Hamlet's Mill, there is actual knowledge of precession built into that Norse mythology. I should have a few more of the details, but
they were consummate seafarers. I mean, it's what they relied upon through long stage of their history. And if you are going to be a consummate seafarer, you're going to have consummate knowledge of the stars.
Yeah, I think there's that, and I think the other aspect of it that you could consider is that while the Norse themselves may not have had overt knowledge of, certainly they knew how to navigate by the stars, and they probably knew the motions of the heavens. But to the degree where you can precession, because precession to actually even measure it, the sun only moves 1 degree on the. So if you're looking at a horizon, you stand on a hill, you've got a 360 degree view of the horizon. The sun underneath this processional sky only moves a perceptible 1 degree on the horizon every 72 years. So that's it takes a long time to even notice that precession is going on. But the funny thing is, this is what Hamlet's Mill shows, is that even though from what we understand of many ancient cultures, while they themselves, in fact, even the Catholic and our culture, there's so much interesting work here when you look at the symbolism between Jesus and his 12 disciples, Jesus being, you know, a sun, basically you can equate it to a sun cult, and you can also pull processional knowledge out of the Christian religion.
For sure.
Well, it's a sun god with 12 disciples, 12 processional cycles. Jesus, what people drive around with a fish on the back of their car that says Jesus on it. We're currently in the age of Pisces. I mean, what did Jesus feed the people? It was fish and bread. Who did he make into his disciples? They were fishermen. Jesus walked on water. Yeah. If you look at the age before the age of Pisces, which we're currently in, it was the age of Aries, the ram. I mean, and this was, if you quite, we're at the end of the age of Pisces, so you're talking about roughly 2,000 years ago. So when Jesus was born, we were coming out of the age of Aries, the ram, into the age of the fish, Pisces, the fish. And if you look at what happened before Jesus, go to Old Testament, it's Moses. What did Moses use? He blew the ram's horn. I mean, right. There's a lot of analogies towards the goat and the ram when you look in the story of Moses. And the one last thing I'll add on to that is that if you look at the age before Moses, which is the age of Taurus, the bull.
Yes, yes.
When Moses, the age, what's this, the creation story with Moses? Moses came down from the Mount Sinai, he had the tablets, to find his worshippers doing what? Do you know? They were worshipping, they were worshipping a golden calf. Yes. What does that represent? It represents the age of Taurus. And actually, just to round this out, there's the one other aspect of this, and this is something that's written in the Bible. It's kind of an interesting quote. It's been misinterpreted over the years. The King James Version is a slightly different version, but effectively there is a question that I think his disciples, Paul, someone asked Jesus. They said, "What happens? How long will you be with us, O Lord?" And he says, "I will be with you till the end of an age," or it's actually until the end of some. It's been interpreted a few different ways, but effectively it means the end of an era, the end of an age, and what it means is it's the end of the Pisces, end of the age of Pisces, because he says, "Well, what will we do then, O Lord?" And he says, "We'll go into town. Find you a man bearing a pitcher of water, follow him to his house and you will find sustenance," or something like that. And you know, what's the representation of Aquarius? It's a man bearing a pitcher of water. I mean, this stuff's right in front of us half the time. So there's a lot of interesting analysis you can do on it. Sorry, long diversionary story. But
you know, there's a lot that is hidden, you know, in you know, these sort of allegories and stories and tales that it's deliberately encoded so that people don't need to have an understanding of the information that they are learning and repeating. And you know, I think it's done for several reasons, but I think you see that in all religions. But, you know, at a certain point, then it becomes about, you know, sort of the hoarding of this knowledge, keeping it from the populace and only, you know, sharing it where it's, you know, deemed necessary.
I mean, in terms of the... Yeah, go.
If you look at the, you know, the accoutrements and the symbols that, you know, a lot of the Egyptian priests carried and wore, you know, the hook and the scepter and the mitre, you know, this is stuff that you see it all in the Catholic Church. You know, it's just these things that are sort of absorbed into the next version of whatever it is. And I think there's a definite element of something that's behind the scenes that is just kind of morphing with the ages to meet the current requirements of, you know, what that age requires for them to still be there with their, you know, guarding their knowledge and doing their thing in the background and, you know, pulling the strings.
Yeah. They took from many other religions at the time. I mean, this is don't have to go very far to find the allegories towards the horse story and, you know, the biblical flood.
Almost exactly the same in all the essential ways. The story of Horus is the story of Jesus. It's just 3,000 plus years older.
The Council of Nicaea, right? This was 200 years after the time of Jesus. And then, but there's a lot. I mean, religion still plays such a strong role in everything that happens today. We lose sight of that. I think, you know, we're over here in the history world if you're buried in all of this stuff, but. I could tell there's another very good astronomical proof of the allegory of Christianity towards effectively being a sun cult and all of the traditions and the stories that are basically describing movements of the heavens. I mean, one of the best ones is the resurrection story, and this actually happens around December 25th.
Which is not Jesus' birthday.
It was borrowed. It was borrowed, right. But this is actually, so the whole story about being dead and rising and being dead for 3 days and then rising again, this happens, and it happens only in the northern hemisphere. I think it's above a certain line of latitude that you've got to go up, and I will post the details in the video. But if you can go up there and you observe the sky around the end of, and this is effectively the end of, where the, because the sun, when it gets colder and you move into winter, the sun moves south. So on the horizon, if you're looking at where the sun sets, you know, the sun is moving south and your days are getting shorter. And there's at a period of time where the sun, it actually stops moving south and it appears to kind of die on the horizon, and it dies for 3 days. And this happens over a period of around December 25th in the northern latitudes. And then after 3 days, the sun starts to move north again in where it's setting. It's really quite an interesting phenomenon. That's the whole story of the resurrection. Like, is if you consider Jesus to be the sun. I mean, people had a tight relationship to the land. We talked about this earlier, but you have such, when you are in a hunter-gatherer or any sort of society that isn't what is effectively a modern city, where you don't care about, you know, the sun and the cycles of the heavens because it doesn't directly impact the quality of your life, the food you're eating, you know, the animals you depend on, that type of thing. But if you are in that circumstance, when the sun is out, well, you've got summertime, you've got springtime, the animals are plentiful, the grass is growing, your food is growing, food is plentiful. This is the time you want. I mean, and so, you know, the wintertime is also the negative of that. So you pay attention to the seasons and you notice these things. So this is kind of the point, is that once the whole story is encoded into, so once the sun dies on the horizon for 3 days and starts moving north again, that's the resurrection. That's the indication that we're coming back to good times. It's the indication that summer's returning. The sun is coming back. I mean, there is just no end of allegorical references between Jesus and the sun throughout the Bible.
And you encode all this knowledge so that people don't, you know, they don't have to know the specifics, you know, but they can pass it on through the stories. It's the same thing that, in a way, that Laird Scranton talks about with the, you know, with the way that the Dogon have encrypted their, you know, their hieroglyphs over time. There's a lot of scientific knowledge that's stored in the symbols, but how can you can't necessarily give every generation, especially, you know, however many thousands of years ago, the, you know, the scientific training to understand the knowledge that you're giving them. So you make it something that they can understand and repeat, and then at a certain point they're going to figure out, you know, you're going to look at that and go, oh God, they're talking about, you know, the construction of matter and, you know, the speed of light and things like this.
Right. Yeah, it's all in there. There's a lot of interesting data, and again, all of it being indicative that in order for this stuff to be encoded, in order for us to have realized some of these things and to achieve some of these monuments, it all seems indicative. I don't need aliens, and, you know, this doesn't have to come from some supernatural source. We know humans have been here. We know that we're clever buggers, and that we're given time and organization and society, we, given time, can achieve amazing things. And having been here for 200,000 years, all of these things that we look at today, these out-of-place artifacts, these encoded messages, these massive megalithic constructions that are often at the very deepest layers of time and of these sites, all of these are indicative that we've been here for longer than we think we have, and that we've reached heights that may be a little different to our heights, and they're something we don't quite understand. We can't yet look at it in the right frame of reference to make sense of it all. But all of it is indicative of the fact that we were here and we have done something in the past, or at least something's happened in the past. If we leave it here, I would just say, you know, enjoy Gunung Padang, man. I'm jealous. It's going to be a good trip.
Yeah.
Say hello to Raymond. Luke is traveling with a few companions that we have previously traveled with in Egypt and South America. So it's always good to see old friends.
Yeah, you know, I it's going to be really good to see some of these people again. There'll be four of us, I think. But yeah, it's going to be exciting. They're going to get to carry equipment. I don't think they know that yet.